academics, research, and administration. He worked in Bits Pilani for more than a decade, where he held several key positions as the assistant dean, practice school division, was the charge of practice school and placements in Dubai campus, and also editorial in chief for more journals. He was instrumental in establishing practice school internship program at Bits Pilani Dubai campus. He worked as a pro vice chancellor at Kelly University, Guntur, where he is introduced a highly flexible and a transparent academic structure through standardized system and process. He also served as a GMR group as a director for education and provost at vice president level at Rajam, Andhra Pradesh. He was the founder vice chancellor for the Presidential University, Bangalore. Presently, he is working as a pro vice chancellor at Presidential University, Bangalore. Dr. Nagendra Prasad has published more research articles extensively in the renowned journals, served as a referee for the several national and international journals, and has authored 2 textbooks in the area of manufacturing and various manuals in the different fields. It's my pleasure, sir. Now I would like to request Dr. Nagendra Prasad, sir, would like to address the participants on the webinar topic, today's webinar topic, sir. Thank you, sir.
Different mechanisms. The last Sunday only I gave a talk on how actually we can bring employability factors into a curriculum design, where university industry linkage is one such a factor we are emphasized. Based on the overwhelming response of the audience, I thought like I should continue it further. In this today's topic, I'll be discussing on how can we bring university and industry together. See, the university industry linkage term has become a buzzword in the present education system. Unfortunately, in India, universities and industries, we work in isolation. I mean, universities doesn't know what industry want, and industry doesn't know what university teaches. This is university industry linkage. If I talk as far as our country, India is concerned, it is very much limited to placement and to some extent in internship, and very little in consultancy. Other possibilities have not been explored yet. They are at a nascent stage. Now, that is the reason why actually I have taken a very hot topic for today's discussion, that how actually you can bring university and industry together, how each stakeholder, that means the university, industry, the faculty, the students, at the large society, how they can be benefited. This is the topic of my discussion in today's discussion. Now, I'll start my discussion with assertions about this university industry linkage program. University has got its own assertions and industry has got its own assertions. What are those assertions? I'll start my discussion with that. Then I get into the motivating factors. What makes industry and university to come together? What are those motivating factors? And next I will discuss what are the different methods by which they can come together. And finally, the benefits to the all stakeholders. This is the topic of my discussion. Let me start my discussion with assertions and counter assertions, what universities and industries are going to make on each other. See, I also already mentioned there exists a clear gap between university and industry. I said university doesn't know what industry wants. I'm not generalizing any of my statements throughout the discussion. What I say is majority. Most of the universities or institutions in the country doesn't know what industry expects, and industry doesn't know what universities are. Developing a proper structural relationship between university and industry is a challenging problem and is a complex process. There is a chicken egg problem. Chicken first or egg first. There is a chicken egg problem. In Hindi, what we call it as tutu meme. That means university says that industries are not coming forward. Industry says that universities are not coming forward. And that blame game is going on since decades. There has always been a complaint from the industry that university produces such products which are of no relevance to the industry. And universities complain that industries do not get to know in a structured way about their expectations. I'll come to the details of this. Industry says that what universities are producing is of no use to us. But why are they not coming forward to help? Or why universities are not going forward to take the help of industries? There was a joke. Once a married man goes to a Swamiji and tells Swamiji, he just get married and asks Swamiji, "Swamiji, how will be my married life?" Swamiji says, "For next 5 years, you have problems." This man gets delighted and says that, "Oh, after next 5 years, I'm happy." Then Swamiji says, "All my problems will be over 5 years. Then Swamiji says, "No, beta, after 5 years, you'll be used to that problem." See, what I mean to say here is, even industries are used to the type of output what universities are producing. They make a complaint that they have no choice, they have to recruit them only, and they are also used to it. And today's topic, I'll come to that, how actually you can fill that gap. Now let me highlight what are the assertions of industry and university, because without knowing what are the point of view of an industry and university, you can't bridge the gap. See, one major assertion of the industry is, universities do not change their curriculum to meet the modern technological needs. It's very much true. It happens in most of the universities that the curriculum what they teach is outdated. So it is true in most of the institutions. And they also say that faculty of universities they come on that. They come and teach that without seeing that even. It happens. It's true. Educational institutions make no effort to inculcate discipline and corporate work ethics in the students. See, the expectation of corporate culture is different, and that is not being taught during the study period. True. Taking students for internship is a waste of time and there is no outcome, because it is unmonitored. There is no involvement of faculty. There is no involvement of university or institute. So students come at their convenience, go at their convenience. We don't know what they do. So taking student for internship is a waste of time. True in most of the cases. Now, research at university. They also blame on research at university. Research at university is not time-bound and mission-oriented and is of no relevance to industry. Fine, accept it. It's true in most of the cases that we academicians, we do research in the area of interest of our choice, not what company wants. Next. What are the assertions by university then? Industries, now, there are assertions by university as well. These are all the assertions of industry. Now come to the assertions of the university. Industries do not cooperate and show no interest in taking student trainees. Yes, when I meet the company for taking the students for interns or anything, most of the industries are reluctant. They do not cooperate. They say that it's not a training place. I don't have time to train. All these things they say. Now, the industries have, other assertion of the university is that industries have little interaction with education institutions to communicate the type of curriculum, discipline, and work culture required by them. You only say that they are not produced to the expectations, but you don't say what you expect. What are the corporate culture? What are your curriculum expectations? These things about that you are silent, but you put a blame on us. That's another assertion. Then, experts from industry have no time to visit universities and participate in teaching. Yeah, these are all the assertions made by the university. They are not far from truth. Either the assertions made by the university or from industry, they are not far from truth. I'm not generalizing, as I told. I'm not generalizing any of my statements. But these assertions and counter-assertions are not far from truth, my dear friends, because the priority of university and industries are different. That's the major, as I already told you, it's a complex phenomenon. The reason for that is that the priorities of university and industry, you take the example of industries. Most of the industries look for commercial benefit, whereas academicians, we look only for publications. This is the major limitation. See, I told commercial benefit. When I was talking to one of my friends' company in Bangalore, I was asking him, it's my own friend's company, I was asking him for an internship. You know what he told? Nakendra, I'll take your student for internship program, but each chair space, the company is in Whitefield, where floor space is costly. He says that each chair space cost me 35,000 rupees a month. If your student can produce more than 35,000 rupees a month, let him come. Otherwise, no. They are of commercial interest. But we academicians, we look only from the academic perspective. There is no commercial looking and there is no academic thinking from their side. So priorities are different. Priorities are different. That we need to understand. That's a complex phenomenon that we need to build the gap. Now, as I told you, we academicians, we look at publications, you know, like plotting graph, developing equations, and industries is that whatever you do is of no use to us. It's not far from truth. I'll give you an example. In 1997, I had been to NIT Warangal for the publication of presenting my own paper in an AMTDR conference. One of my friend who came for a presentation was showing all the graphs that he did it in ANSYS, on all these software tools. He made some animations and he was showing graphs, everything. And this is an AMTDR conference. It's a conference which is attended by most industry people also. One industry person from Pune stood up and told, gentlemen, I don't want your graphs. I don't understand. Gentlemen, I don't want your equations. I don't understand head and tail of what you're showing. Just tell me, this is my problem. What is your solution? Can your graph, can your equation solve my problem? Tell me that. Bold, completely bold. My friend could not answer that at all. That means that's what they say. Whatever the research in most of the cases, the research you do in the academic institutions is of no relevance to us. Yes, it is equally true that industries also show little or no interest in curriculum development and their representation is confined only for Board of Studies meeting because there is a mandate by the statutory bodies that the Board of Studies should have a representation from your industry. So they call somebody from industry and the informations are not circulated to them that what the homework that they have done. They sit in the morning till evening and they decide the fate of some 50 courses and their aids. That is not the way of involving an industry people for curriculum development. I'll get into the details of it in the down the line in my discussions. But at the present stage, as I told you, as far as curriculum development is concerned, the involvement of industry people is confined only to the participation of meeting in Board of Studies and is not taken beyond that. It is university, it is departments who should come forward. I'll give you one simple example how actually you can fill it. Many companies visits your institute for placement. Have you ever talked to them about their expectations? If you've already spoken, I know most of the institution know it. Note it down on a piece of paper, involve head of the department. Let head of the department interact with the concerned company. Get to know about their expectations, prepare a note. And when you design your curriculum for presenting it in Board of Studies, discuss on that, debate on that, and then put it. That bridges the gap between university and industry, just not by involving one person on the day of BOS meeting without giving any information to him. If you bring him, it doesn't solve any problems. Rather, it only satisfies the statutory requirement that yes, there is a representation of industry in the BOS. Other than that, you are not achieving anything. Now, whatever may be the assertions and counter-assertions of the university and industry, there are several motivating factors out there. Yes, there are several motivating factors out there why they should come up. Now, let me get into the motivating factors. Then I will discuss how they can be done. Okay. Now, what are those motivating factors? See, whatever may be the prejudices, between academia and industry, they have started breaking up. Because, you know, they should come together. See, once I had been to a company in Bangalore, the chief managing director, it's a very big civil company. The chief managing director was still mentioning that, you know, like, see, you people do not produce civil engineers. They are glorified maestries. Like, he was calling a civil engineering graduate as a glorified maestri. You take it or not take it. But it is true in most of the institutions. They don't know this. They don't know that. All things they were mentioning. Then I asked him, sir, why don't you visit our institute and interact with my department people and give your inputs? He willingly agreed. And he visited. There was a meeting between my civil department group and the concerned person, CMD, and they had a nice interaction. He gave input. Such type of interactions has to happen regularly, not once in a while, has to happen regularly. Then only it is possible for institutes to produce graduates to the requirement of the market. Well, as I told you, like there are things are breaking up and young blood is coming, you know, like gone are the days, you know, like it's not required. See, I was working in one of the universities in a good institution in Andhra Pradesh. I'm telling you the history of 30 years back. One head of the Department of Computer Science went and met the principal and asked him that we'll start placement here, placement cell. The principal said, it may be 40 years back. The principal said, when we graduated, did anybody give us a job? Did we not go and find it? Let them go and find the job. Don't encourage all these things. But he went and met the management. The president was a visionary. He took the challenge and he started placement. Placement cell. Probably that was the first placement cell in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Like that, now England is coming. They're breaking all these barriers and they're coming forward and we are bridging the gap now. Now, what are those motivating factors? The motivating factors are there for industry. First, let me start with industry. See, in a competitive market, there is existing a rat eat competition. A rat race competition is existing amongst the industry. In this condition, availability of technological information plays a major role. Availability of technological information plays a major role. This technological information is available cheaply in universities. Say, for example, I'll give an example. International Journal for Production Research, it costs in terms of lakhs to subscribe. But most of the universities, they subscribe, but not industries may not be offered to subscribe it. So such type of many online journals, the technological information in terms of center of excellences, laboratories, sophisticated equipments, they are all available in the good institutions. If industry and university can collaborate with each other, then these type of technological informations can be of use to industry. That is one motivating factor why they should come forward. This plays a major role. Say for example, another thing, like today's faculty and students, they come with fresh minds. They think out of the box. They're not conventional, not like us when we graduated. They think out of the box. They're having fresh minds. Say, for example, when I was working as an internship in charge at the BITS Pilani Dubai campus, I still remember the students were undergoing 8-week internship program and it was in a company called Strategic Food in Dubai. The students are just 2 years completed. When they sat for group discussion, it was an evaluation component on the topic what they have done. The project was undergoing. The top man, still I remember him, he got so excited by the way my students started putting their ideas and views in solving problem, immediately hold the discussion for a while and he called all his colleagues, said to participate. Because they are thinking in a direction which we are not thinking. They are thinking in the direction involved. Same experience I encountered, I experienced it in another company called Mindscape in Dubai. First, they told what these second year students can do. It's a waste of time. I don't participate in evaluation component group discussion. But when I requested him, sir, you start participating. If it excites you, continue. Otherwise, you can leave. He was so excited, the CEO of the company. The group discussion was scheduled for 15-20 minutes. It extended for 2 hours because he started asking questions and get to know how my students are solving the problem. So this is happening with the present generation, my dear friends. The young faculty members, the students are thinking out of the box. And most of the cases, there are cases out there who think that there is no box. So such type of thinking, fresh mind, comes to industry. It is of use to you. So they are coming forward. Next, other motivating factor for industry. They can have a permanent access to facilities or skills and technical advice from the institutions. See, many researchers are going. And these researchers, you know, like as already told, graphs, equations, and things like this, this is not a cup of tea for an industry fellow to understand that. It involves a lot of mathematical models, things like this. But if you have an access to academia, you can get to know what is that and what is this. That is another motivating factor. They can have a permanent access to facilities or skills to solve some severe technical problems or get general technical advice from the institution is the biggest advantage. That is one motivating factor. Now, what motivates university institution, education institutions to come forward now? One thing, my dear friends, the strong motivating factors, it improves the image of the institution before the society. You take any ranking media, statutory body requirement, call it as NAC, now call it NAC MBA, call it ABET, any accreditation process, major thing that they wanted to answer is that, what are your industry relations? Other than placement, what are you doing with? Internship, consultancy, center of excellence, faculty visit to industry, industry involvement in projects, your involvement in industry projects, what are that you are doing? We are supposed to answer. Otherwise, we get lower rankings. That is strong motivating factors. That is driving the education institutions. You know, like teaching and research is happening on almost all the institutions, but this university industry linkage is happening in very few universities. So you need to come forward. That is one strong motivating factor for industry, for university to get into university industry linkage. Next, they can provide some financial benefit. I know one institution in Coimbatore, where part of the salary of the faculty member is paid by the industry, because he involves in solving industry problems. It's a very good credit for the institution. And they can find an additional income. And especially if you are deputing your students for internship program, and if it is done in a way it should be done, I'll discuss internship program later. More chances are there that the students get recruited in the company wherever they have interned. That's the biggest advantage, so that your percentage of placement will increase. And if you take consultancy program from industries, you can get an, you means industry, university and faculty can get an additional income. So these are all the things which motivates university and industry that why they should come forward for collaboration. Now I told assertions from university and industry. Then I told now motivating factor for university and industry. Now I'm getting into the crux of my talk. How university and industry can come together. How this thing can happen. See, there are several methods by which university and industry can come together. As already mentioned in the beginning of my discussion, unfortunately in India, it is very much confined to placement and internship. It happens for placement, 100%. It's not a collaboration, it's a visit. For some institutions, they started with internship. And very few institutions have got consulted, very few. Now I'm getting into the crux of my talk, like how you can come forward. One such a tool you can come together is an effective tool to start with is an internship program. See, internship program is not a new concept. It's an age-old technique. But it's not done in a way it should be done. I can take a separate session on how to conduct in the internship program successfully. I can take a separate session on that down the line. I confine my discussion only how to conduct it in a very brief manner. Say, for example, many institutions send their students for internship program for a short duration of 15 days, 20 days, 1 month like this. I'm telling you, I can stand on Himalayas and tell this short duration is of no use at all, because they can go see company, feel that mission, this mission, they can see and come back, which is of no use. They can see the mission, that's all. They can't experience it. Even industry does not encourage this short duration internship works. Industries does not encourage it. Don't go with a request of 15 days, 20 days, 1 month. The reason is industry people are very genuinely, they give an answer that by the time they get to know the company, their internship period is over, then they buzz off. And what is my game here? They're right. They're right. So I strongly recommend the duration should be for a minimum period of one semester. Minimum period of one semester. They can go for 1 year also. No, it's possible. It's possible. One semester internship program is the one which I strongly recommend. It should be in final year so that they have studied almost all core courses. It can be in seventh or eighth semester for engineering program. Even I implemented this program for BSc BCom also, one full semester program. I implemented it in one university. So BSc BCom in third year, either of the semesters, they can go. So duration should be for a minimum period of one semester. And if you go and approach industry people saying that the student who is in final year, who is about to graduate, comes and spends time with you for 1 month, 1 semester, it's difficult for them to say no. They take it. One is duration. Second thing, make it as an institutionalized process. That means let the university find company, let the university depute student, monitor it, conduct evaluation component, and then give a grade. This is the way it should be done. What happens in other universities now? They ask the student to find companies. They go, they come back, they come with the report, they come with the certificate, and for that some marks is given. And industry people have a genuine complaint here. I met at least 10,000 companies in last 20 years, I can say. So many CMDs and CEOs I have met, thousands of people I have met. The one major assertion is that, you know, like duration. Second thing, sir, it is not monitored by your institute. They don't come here. Your faculty does not come here. Your university is not involved. Student, they take a consent. They come here for 1 day and they skip for the entire semester. And then they come at the end asking for a certificate. Comes now and then, don't involve, don't show interest. You people also do not come. They are all right. So do it in a structured way where we monitor the program, depute a faculty once in a week at least to visit the company, get to know what is happening. Then it is possible that a successful internship is possible. Can you do it that way? If you can do it that way, have an internship. Otherwise, don't have it. Otherwise, you spoil the image of your own institution. Next, as I told you, faculty involvement must be there. This is another assertion, as I mentioned earlier. The faculty does not expose themselves practically. Now, what does don't send them only for monitoring that they present or absent? No, that's not the case here. Let the faculty involve in problem solving also. Let them spend 1 day in a week in industry and get to know. The quality of teaching also will improve. Conduct evaluation components like group discussion, seminar, viva, all pertaining to the project assigned by the company to them. And if you have components like this, seminar, group discussion, viva, things like this, then definitely the soft skills of a student like interpersonal skills, communication skills, presentation skills, confidence levels, these things are going to improve, which are looked by the company people at the time of recruitment, which enhances the employment opportunity for a student. So my dear friends, this is internship is one such a thing. And I request industry people, you put these conditions to the institute before you take them for an internship program. You put these conditions. Is it faculty monitored? Then only I'll give permission. Is it for a semester? Then only I'll give permission. Do you involve your project company here, faculty here? Then only I'll give permission. Put this. I encourage industry people to put this condition. I visited one company in Bangalore 6-7 months back. They put another method. I loved it. Do you know what they say? Let your faculty come here first. Choose the problem. What they can solve. And then involve students in it. I'll give you. Fine. Good method. This is the way. Industries are coming forward now. But you should encash it. Now I request another appeal to industry people. I know many industry participants are there in this seminar. Another appeal for you is pay stipend. You take a final year student who is about to graduate, pay stipend for him. Because there is a motivation for student. If he gets a stipend, there is a motivation. There is a commitment. There's a commitment for you also to extract the work. Or otherwise, you can say, I have seen many companies in Dubai, they used to say, we will pay the stipend at the end of the semester based on the satisfaction levels. Fine. Accept it. See, welcome the industry people when you approach them for an internship program to come and choose the students if you want. Instead of me deputing the student, that means institute deputing the student, you tell them, you come here, you take the student, whom you like, you interview them, conduct us, whatever you want. And another request for industry people, recruit interns. You train them for a semester. You are happy. If there is a vacancy, recruit them and tell it in the beginning. Based on the successful completion of the internship program, you will be recruited. Like that, you see. This increases the motivation level of a student and enables them to perform better. And see, I approached at least 75 to 80 companies in the last 7-8 months in Bangalore. Most companies, they are open for this challenge. Yes, they are ready for that. And also one more appeal to my industry people. Please do not expect returns all the time in an internship program or whenever you work with faculty and students. Please treat this as a contribution to the society. You are also having a corporate social responsibility to train the students, to train the young faculty, and to contribute it back to the society. Do it in the form of internship, do it in the form of an industry lecture, do it in any form you feel it convenient for you, but please do it. This is internship, I told. And since the internship program is something close to my heart, I can talk for days together. I'll confine my internship program here itself. Now I come to another thing. In PhD programs. See, as I already told you, most of the cases in academia, we do PhD in another hypothetical case. We assume problem, we solve it, we develop a complex mathematical model. Other than the guide and researcher, nobody knows it. And we plot some graphs with different colors and we make some analysis, produce some thesis and get degree certificate. What I'm suggesting is that, why can't you register for a PhD problem, for a PhD on an industrial problem in collaboration with industry? Academicians should think in the direction. Instead of assuming a hypothetical problem, take an area, go to an industry, choose the problem there, involve a professional expert from the host organization also as a guide and your university guide. Let them work together, let all of us work together and solve the problem. It is of use to industry, it is of use to academia, gap is filled also. That is beautiful. And there is another thing, even company employees can register a PhD. And companies work, whatever the domain on which I know many of my friends who are working in a particular, they continue to do that work, but they bring an academic touch into it for registering for PhD. Fine. You can work under the supervision of both academia and industry. I know many institutions like the Indian Institute of Science and BITS Pilani, they give a waiver of master's degree for these type of employees who wanted to register for PhD, BE, PhD, no M.Tech in between. No MEM Tech in between. They give a waiver for that. I know many institutions does this. This is the way, like you can think to bridge the gap. This is one, the PhD program is one thing. And there is another thing called as center of excellence. This is another way you can bridge together or you can come together. This is not the center of excellence, is not a way like what we academicians think, sophisticated laboratory. Here it means to me an essentially a center of research where students and faculty from various disciplines along with industrial persons are involved in ongoing activities of industry. That means they take an ongoing activity of industry and solve it in the university. And I know some universities, they award academic credits also for this. See, when I was working in Dubai campus, which is Dubai campus, many companies want to come forward to start up a center in the university. Because we had a successful internship program. Many of my students used to get placed based on their performance. So they used to have, they come forward. They say that, you know, like, Nagendra, we want to start a center of excellence here. That means we wanted to invest here in your university. The reason is that in Dubai, the space is costly. So they can have our space, they can have our technical expertise, and they work on their problem, involving my faculty, involving my student. It is a benefit to them. The same is case in Bangalore, Hyderabad, where space is costly. Space is costly here. So you can offer this type of challenge to the company people to come and start laboratories here, where on an industry problem, we work together. And if you find it worth, even universities can give credits for the students. I know universities give credits for this type of involvement of a student. So this type of, this is one such a possibility. Another possibility is go for a research contract. In this contract, what happens? Company enters into a research contract with an academic institution. In this mechanism, what industry will do is that it purchases successfully completed research project from the institution for their specific use. See, I know many institutions are very strong in a particular area, maybe biotechnology or civil surveying, some area that are very strong. If you make industry people convinced that you are very strong in that area, what they wait for you is that if you say that this is the ongoing research in our university or an institution, they will purchase the research results once it is completed by paying money. This is one another method. All that you need to do is that you have to go to industry and say that you are strong here. This is the ongoing projects. You have to go there and say, this is how it is relevant to industry. Also, you have to market. Otherwise, they don't come. This is the area on which we are working. This is how it is useful to your company for your product. If you can convince them, they will purchase it. It's possible. Another thing. You can go for a consulting agreement. Consulting agreement means, under this system, a company employs a faculty member of an institution to act as a consultant for a company on a part-time basis. Same example I have given you earlier. I know an institution in Coimbatore. A part of the salary of a faculty is borne by the company. He visits weekly 2 days maximum, and remaining 4 days he spends in the company. That is the level. See, this it helps in image building. It helps in filling the gap between university and industry. It is possible, my dear friends. There is nothing. There is no rocket science. I am not talking any rocket science here. This is all common sense. It's possible. It's possible. We can do it. And another thing is that affiliate program. This is another method by which you can collaborate. What is this affiliate program? In this mechanism, the industry pays an annual fee to your faculty or department of an institution for preferential access of research results for a help with a specific research program. What I mean here is the industry gives an annual fee to the department per annum, so much of money. And the research results of your department or university is taken by them. This is a very good method. See, this type of linkage was first introduced in MIT USG. They have done it. First introduced in MIT USG. They have introduced it. So this affiliate program is another thing that you can think. another method. This industry people can think. This is called as research consortia or industry cooperatives, we call it. What? Research consortia or industry cooperatives. What happens? In this mechanism, a few companies having same type of business but having no capacity to spend on specific research work, work independently, pool their finances for a collective research effort that would benefit all the members of the group. What I mean is that we come together, pool our financial resources, and then invest on a particular place and get all of us will get benefit. See, this is called as research consortia, we call it. The industry people are academicians. You take initiative, you pull up similar companies, say that, sir, your product is same, means your problem must be same, and we are here to find a common problem to the solution to the common problem. And this will be our charges. I'll give you a classical example. The Council of Chemical Research is an example of research consortium in the USA. Council of Chemical Research, just browse it in the net. Council of Chemical Research is an example of research consortium in the USA. So these institutions, they pulled up companies, they formed this consortia, then they hired a university, and they do it. See, I can give you a comparison here. In 2009, when I was working in the state of Andhra Pradesh, one of the university, what they did is, see, they wanted to have guest lectures by foreign faculty. Because, you know, it goes for an image building. But if one institution has to bring the person from US, UK, Australia, it would be very costly. So what they did, the like-minded universities in the adjacent taluks and districts, they pulled up the resources. They said that we will call a person, when he visits here, let him stay for 3 days, 5 days, visit all the institution, and we will bear the share the expenses. Beautiful model. That worked out. That worked out. Like that, pool of companies who are having a common problem can pool together to find a common solution, or any university itself can drive this initiative. They say that you are all the common industries who are having common problem. Here is a solution with us. Come. What's wrong? This is another thing. Another method where you can collaborate. It's almost existing in most of the reputed companies with reputed universities. Train the trainer. In this method, faculty member from the university visit the industry and train professional experts of industry in selected areas of mutual interest, or professional experts from industry visit university and train the faculty members in selected areas. Both are happening. It's happening. Say, for example, many companies, they put a thing that, you know, like, if you purchase my package, I'll give free training. Fine. See, for example, on a niche area, if you don't have an exposure, if you wanted us to try, you can approach the concerned university which has an expertise in that particular domain and ask them for a consultancy. Fine. This program is called as Train the Trainer program. This is one method. Another method is Technology Innovation Center, or Science Park, they call it. What is this? Technology Innovation Center or Science Park. This is a mirror image of the internship program. This is a mirror image of the internship program. In essence, in Technology Innovation Center or Science Park, it's a formal unit created by the university to help industries to help themselves. It's a formal unit created by the university to help industries to help themselves. What do we do? The industries for whom this center is designed are knowledge intensive than capital intensive or labor intensive. In internship program, students and faculty visit the industry for a stipulated period of time. Here in this Science Park method, professional experts from the organization spend time in the university along with faculty and students of that institution. This is the beauty. So it's the reverse of internship program. This is also a good method. There is another thing called, this is another way you can build it, bridge the gap. This is called as industrial liaison officer or technology transfer office. I'm not talking any rocket science here. All that I'm trying to give a new dimension to the existing thing, the what you are having. Say, for example, you are having a placement cell. What placement cell will do? It goes to companies, find companies, and enable them for a participation. And sometimes placement cell also organizes internship program. That's how you do it. In this model, what I'm insisting, you open an office in the university called a technology transfer office. In this mechanism, a small office is operated in the university in order to bring contracts between academics of that institution and industrial environment and explore possibilities of exploiting research results of the institution. That means these people will go to company and market the research results of the institution and say that this is the ongoing research area, these are the completed research area, this is your product, this is of relevance to you. If you want to use, you can have a further elaborate discussion on this. What's wrong? This is what you do it in a placement office. You know, like placement officers go to the company and say, this is the background of my student, this is the skill set of my students, they can do this for you, they can do that for you, come for placement. You invite. Same thing you do it here for marketing the research results or capability of your faculty members and students. You do the reverse here. The other model here. Here in this model, you go to your company and say, you are making product like this. There is a set of faculty and students who are working in this particular area. Come on, let's have a collaboration. Fine. This is called as technology transfer office. See, there is no rocket science here. It's all thinking out of the box. Yes, if you want to do it, you will do it. Now, all that you need to do is that you need to prepare a brochure. Put your strong on the website details. Prepare a brochure, meet company and do it. See, when I was working for one of the colleges as a director in Andhra Pradesh, we did it something, you know, like, I don't know to call it innovative, some new approach we used. That small village had many constructions going in and around. What we did, we prepared, since constructions were also going, we prepared, in Telugu, we prepared a pamphlet type of thing, not a brochure, pamphlet. If you can come, you can do this in our civil engineering laboratory, some sand testing, some this, that, small thing. Many things happen. Many consultancies happen. So if you go officially and touch it, my dear friends, it is possible. Now, where to start? Where I can break the chicken now first? Start with internship program. That's what I strongly recommend. Start with internship program. Because when you start with internship program, when you do the internship program, the way I told you, that is monitoring, conducting evaluation component, win-win. If you do it that way, you build a confidence in the industry. Yes, there is something what we can do here. This university or institute is worth trust believing. Once if you build that confidence, they start coming set up in laboratories, they start giving consultancy for you, they enroll PhD of their employees with you, all things are possible. You start small way in an internship program. That helps you to develop understandings. Then take it to next level. And university also should come forward to change their HR policies to encourage industry collaboration. See, suppose if I take a consultancy work from a company, most institutions have it. There is nothing new I'm talking. They say that 20% belongs to institution and 80% goes to faculty. Fine. It's the HR policy. So you are motivating them. You are encouraging them to collaborate with the industry. you can also go one step forward. We can adjust the timetable. We can let you one day completely free so that you can go and work one day in the industry, in the company. Fine. If the industry pays, finds this faculty involvement more useful, beneficial, extend that one day to a 2 day to a 3 day and say, ask industry pay part of his salary. Fine. These are all the models what you can think of, my dear friends, how you can collaborate on all these things. These are all the various models that you can think of. Now, before I go for my concluding remarks, why I should collaborate? What is that industry is getting? What is that institution is getting? What is that student is getting? What is that faculty is getting? Let me tell the benefits of the program. See, there is a benefit for the industry, my dear friends, because academicians, young faculty, and students can bring a fresh approach. As I already gave my own experiences, they bring a fresh approach. They can think the problem in an innovative way, creative way, what you can't think. Definitely it is possible that they can think in that way. If you take a student for internship program, you can find a potential employee. You can take the faculty as like work like that. Involve the faculty also. Employed is very encouraging. After realizing all these things, nowadays industry started investing in its resources such as finances and manpower in universities. It's happening, but happening in a small way. I know one of the companies in Dubai where I was working, they used to ask me in the beginning, Nagendra, can you tell me how many students you are going to give me next semester? I asked him. Still, I remember the company name, Globansol. I asked him, why? He says, give me the number of students whom you are deputing. Accordingly, I can plan my manpower. That means industry is planning their manpower based on the number of students that you are going to supply for internship program. This is possible only if the internship program is conducted successfully. You are helping industry and industry in turn is helping you. What a wonderful thing. See, so in that way, industry is getting benefit. Now come to benefits to the institution. Why institution should collaborate? Fasting, image building. I have collaboration with so many companies. Image building. You are improving employment opportunity for outgoing graduates. This is another thing through internship program. Next. You provide financial benefit to your researchers and faculty members. That's another benefit. Above all, it helps in building the gap, bridging the gap between university and industry. So these are all the benefits. And last but not the least, you find an additional income. Why? Why faculty? Now I told for industry, I told for university, now faculty. See, involvement of faculty in ongoing projects of industry can help to upgrade their practical knowledge. See, when I was working in one of the premier institutions in the country, I used to take the caselets from the industry internship report and teach it in the class. That improved my quality of teaching. What we academicians call it as Bloom's taxonomy, I can straight away jump into level number 4 and 5 in my teaching. That helps. If a faculty involves in solving industrial consultancy problem, his confidence level, his interpersonal skills also will improve because he interacts with people whom he doesn't know, which or she doesn't know. So this is another benefit for the faculty members for involving him. See, working with others will always, you know, like value addition and is a confidence building than working with the colleagues whom you know. And it also gives you a change for faculty members from routine teaching. Or I have same building, same chamber, morning, 9 o'clock, 5 o'clock. The same environment, same atmosphere. Let me have a change. One weekly visit, let me once in a week or twice in a week with a company, work with a live problem is also a change. Welcome change. All this adds value to on-campus courses. Your visit to the company, working in a company, definitely
Trust me, it improves your quality of teaching. You become a different teacher altogether. Trust me, trust me. So this was the thing. Now, why a student should be involved? See, already I spoke a lot about this internship program. See, one major benefit for a student is that, you know, like, see, don't confine your student involvement only for internship programs. Beyond that, you think. Say, for example, if you are taking a consultancy work from industry, involve students there also. The major advantage for a student is that while being a student, he works with the life problems, not imaginary problems. So that gives him amazing confidence before graduating. It's a lifelong learning skills and understand. And one such assertion of the industry I told you already. If a student doesn't know corporate culture, this is the major complaint, one of the major complaints. By involving the student in an industry consultancy program or sending him for an internship program, he understands the corporate culture. While being a student, he understands the corporate culture. This is the biggest advantage. And especially if you're having a one-semester internship program in the final year, it enables the student to have a smooth transition from a student life to a professional. See, when we're all graduated, yesterday we were students, tomorrow we become employees. There was a jerk, and that jerk, many of us could not take. But that problem is not faced. If a student is sent for an internship program in final year, he will understand the professional world completely. He improves his soft skills like leadership qualities, communication skills, both written and oral, confidence level, ability to work in a team. Call it any soft skills is enhanced during the internship program or working on a live project. This increases the employment opportunity for an outgoing graduate. This enhances the employment opportunity tremendously. And working with live project use hands-on experience, which in turn increases the confidence level of the student, that I already told. And another biggest advantage is that, you know, like you enable a student to have awareness of his professional strength and limitation while being a student. So you provide a link with a potential employer for a student that increases the marketability of a student. And I'm telling you, when we conducted the internship program at BITS Dubai campus, more than 80% of our students used to get placed in the company wherever they got it. That's the biggest advantage. See, my dear friends, in my discussion, I told you the assertions of the industry, assertions of the university. Despite of being having assertions, there are several motivating factors for both of you to come together. That I told you clearly. And I told you different mechanisms by which you can come together that also have emphasized clearly. And I told you the benefits for all stakeholders. This university industry linkage program not only benefits a student or a faculty or anybody else, it benefits all stakeholders, it benefits industry, it benefits industry institution, faculty, student, and society as a whole, because society gets a good insurance. And to make final remarks, whatever may be the assertions of university and industry, these prejudices have now started breaking up. And there is a growing awareness among both university and industry towards university's linkage for mutual benefit. As I told you, it benefits all stakeholders. To benefit from UIL programs, that is university linkage programs, it is university should be able to integrate their educational programs with the developmental activities of the industries. And also the industry should look at this arrangement as a part of their development strategy. My dear friends of academia, think of involving industry people beyond your board of studies, beyond having a guest lectures. It's more than that. Involve them at every phase. As I already told you, visit before you start your BOS meeting, visit companies. Try to take the feedback of placement companies. Try to take the feedback of companies where your students are interning. Design your curriculum accordingly. Even for industry people, before you put it before BOS, send it well in advance. This is the curriculum that we are discussing. Don't limit it for one area. Call people from different areas. Have a strong BOS. Have a strong curriculum. Because in my last discussions, I was telling, if the academia is good, then only placement will happen. If the academics is poor, placements will not happen. Wish you all the best. Hope to meet you soon on one or the other discussions. I thank the organizers, Adhish Shankara Group of Institutions, the chairman, vice chairman, the director, and Computer Science HOD, for everybody taking this initiative and giving me an opportunity. Thank you all. Thank you very much.
Sir, hello. Hello. Sir, please accept our sincere appreciations for the outstanding presentation you made on industry, university industry linkage and different mechanisms. On behalf of Adhish Shankara Group of Institutions, I want to thank you for your insightful presentation. We are grateful for the time and efforts you took to share our thoughts and experiences on industry institute interface. It was very interesting and informative and set a new levels of analysis on the subject and made an everlasting impression. Our participants who are inside interviewed for new possibilities, in particular your enthusiasm and contagious, and won the hearts of our entire participants. I also thank our chairman, Adhish Shankara Group of Institutions, Dr. Vanki Pinchalaya Garu, for creating this noble platform. I thank from my core of my heart the director, principal and technical staff of Department of CSC for the successful arrangement of this session. Tomorrow, we are conducting one more session on a topic called as Challenges in Research, Publications Ethics. All the participants, please do participate in this session and make this lockdown period effectively. I thank once again for your stimulating speech. Last but not the least, I thank all the participants for their active participation. All the participants, you will receive certificates to register email IDs within 1 hour. Stay tuned. Here I sign off. Dhananjay, Professor and Head of the Department, EC. Thank you once again, sir.
Thank you. Thank you.